Dear students, yeah, I want to continue with the medical visualization lecture and in particular the lecture on interaction techniques related to medical volume data, and I want to do so with a short recap. We looked primarily in transfer functions in the last video lecture, and this will be the case today as well. So there are a number of interesting variants of transfer functions. They are all motivated by the observation that with medical volume data, it is often very difficult and in fact often even impossible to discriminate different tissue types just by one-dimensional transfer functions applied to intensity values alone. I think still the most popular extension of one-dimensional transfer functions are two-dimensional transfer functions that consider intensity, that's the x range here, and gradient magnitude, that's the y-axis, as the two dimensions in order to discriminate structures that should be visible. Yeah, that was an image I showed in the last video lecture. So with this rectangular region selected here within the joint histogram of intensity and gradient magnitude, a wide range of intensity values is considered. And also a considerable range of gradient magnitude values, but these are quite high. So that means with this specification, we are interested in regions where we have a high gradient magnitude. We see here in a selected slice what this means, namely it includes everything that is red here as well. And you see that only a rather small portion of the voxels fulfill this condition. And in the rendering, you may see that indeed regions with high gradient magnitude are shown. So the transition between air and skin is visible very well. And the second transition that is visible very well relates to the colon. Yeah, so the structure that you see here is the colon. The colon is air filled. That means it has very low values and much lower values than the surrounding. So this way you can emphasize the colon. Yeah, I commented a bit on these arcs that are typical here for a material transition within histograms of gradient magnitude and intensity. A system even may suggest transfer functions that emphasize such an arc, provide a template that can be easily adapted. Yeah, so that was done. Yeah, that was the recap related to gradient-based transfer function. Another kind of two-dimensional transfer functions involves the object ID as a second dimension. So that is, of course, a different situation, a quite strongly different situation, because the object ID is something discrete. Yeah, we have a certain number of pre-segmented objects, for example, the different lobes of the lung. We assign one object ID to each of them, and instead of one global transfer function, we have a couple of local transfer functions for each segmented object, in this case for the lung lobes. Yeah. So here in this principal sketch from Christoph Resk-Salama's seminal PhD thesis in 2002, we see four tags. Yeah, computer scientists always start counting with zero. So that is for the first object, for the second, the third, and the fourth object. Yeah, each of them has a transfer function. It is discretized to a lookup table, as we discussed, because that's much faster. And the application is realized completely by means of the graphics hardware. And that can be done for a number of local transfer functions. Yeah, it's limited, of course, by the memory that is available for such lookup tables. But with today's hardware, it's really no problem that you have a number of objects, could be even 20 to 30 objects, when the transfer function for each individual object is represented by a lookup table with just 256 values. Yeah, so that would work. Of course, you cannot interpolate here over the boundary. Yeah, that is really something you have to restrict. You can interpolate here between the different values, but not across the boundary. So this is an example where this was applied. Yeah, you may recognize that this is Mewis Lab renderer, so that's available in Mewis Lab as well. And you see indeed here is an example where we have four different structures, namely three lung lobes shown here with different colors. And the fourth object is basically everything else. Yeah, so that's not explicitly segmented, it is just the background, everything that does not belong to one of the three lung lobes. That gets a transfer function that applies the intensity values to opacity and gray values, whereas the three lung lobes in which we are particularly interested, that are mapped to distinct colors. And the question is how we assign the values for these objects to opacity. To come up with these images here, the transfer function related to intensity is chosen such that only the high intensity structures are shown, namely the contrast enhanced vascular structures. Yeah? So this is how you can create an image like this with tacked volume rendering, or one could also say with using local transfer functions. These are synonyms that means the same. We discussed already the idea of supporting the transfer function specification by templates. Yeah? We looked into one-dimensional templates using the example of Castro and colleagues, where we can create tent-like functions or ramp-like functions or trapezoidal functions with a few parameters, yeah, like you see here the half window size, or here is another parameter that characterizes the steepness of a trapezoidal function. If we use two-dimensional transfer functions, and the second dimension should not be the object idea, but gradient magnitude, curvature, or as we will also see, could also be the size of features or the shape of features, so then we have continuous values in a two-dimensional domain. So one can think of the idea, are there similar templates also for two-dimensional transfer functions? Support for the user in the specification is even more required when we have a two-dimensional domain that has more parameters, more degrees of freedom, so therefore support really is essential. Yeah? So here are some examples. In this master thesis from Andreas Tappendeck back, he developed in total 16 of these templates, yeah, also tent-like structures in two dimensions, for example, or look at this, that's the ramp function in two dimensions. So the user then can drag these control points and move them away in order to specify such a template. And that can be applied in principle to any two-dimensional transfer function where we have a continuous domain in both directions. Yeah? The specific example Andreas Tappenbeck was interested in was a kind of transfer function where the second dimension was the distance to a target object. Yeah? And we will see examples for this use cases where this is quite helpful. Yeah? So template-based specification is helpful. Also similarly to one-dimensional transfer function, also the 2D transfer function should be stored in a lookup table so that it has not to be explicitly evaluated for every voxel in the rendering process. And you may imagine that gets a bit more difficult because if we want to have I would say a minimum useful resolution of 256 entries in both dimensions, then we need a lookup table size of 65,536. Yeah, that's 256 squared. Meanwhile, this is possible, and most graphics hardware have this available. At the time when this was developed, that was still raw. Yeah, so examples are intensity and gradient magnitude or intensity and distance to a target structure, and we will see even more examples. Yeah. For the more fine-grained manipulation, it makes sense that the user not only is able to adapt any of these control points by moving it downward or topwards to increase or decrease this particular value, but also to enable the user to say she wants to refine the grid, yeah, by adding another point here, for example. Internally, we decided to represent this as a rectilinear grid. That is a good trade-off between completely regular grids that have only a very limited flexibility, since the distance between two adjacent control points has to be the same everywhere, and on the other hand, completely irregular grids. Yeah. So if you have a rectilinear grid and want to insert a new control point, originally we had the blue points only, and then we inserted the red point, then we have to make sure that we add a complete row of control points and a complete column of control points. Yeah. So in this example, we had to add 8 additional points, although we are only interested in this one. Yeah. So that's a consequence of a rectilinear grid. With a regular grid, we would say we increase the resolution, and so we have to increase it everywhere. Yeah. So then we would have new rows of control points here as well, and also here and here. That would lead to even much more points. Yeah. So with a distance-based transfer function or distance-dependent transfer function, we have two kinds of input. On the one hand, the medical data set we are interested in, and on the second data set, a tagged volume that represents for one or more target structures which voxels belong to this target structure, and to this target structure a distance transform is applied, which means that for all other voxels not belonging to the target structures, it is computed what is their distance to the target structure. That is rounded to integer values, so we don't want to see a value like 0.7536, but it's 1 or 2 or 3. That makes some computations also a bit easier and faster. Yeah? So a distance transform applied to a large volume data set is something that's computationally quite expensive. So therefore, acceleration really is essential. We may use an editor for 2D transfer functions, as briefly shown in the last slides, represented internally by rectilinear grid. Yeah. Why this could be a good idea? I mean, we are in the medical visualization lecture, so I should not describe techniques that are just interesting from an academic point of view. But there should be a clinical motivation and a clinical application. And I think the most important clinical application is diagnosis and treatment planning in case of cancer, yeah, where we have tumors and we are interested in understanding very well the spatial surrounding within certain margins around the tumor. Yeah. So our target structure here would be one tumor, or in case of a metastatic disease, could be also 3-4 metastases, and we want to control the visual appearance of the structures in the surrounding of that tumor. Yeah. So the first example that I will show basically reveal what is possible with distance-based transfer functions, but this example is not particularly meaningful. Yeah. So here we have the specification of our transfer function, which basically says we are interested in certain intervals of Hounsfield units, intensity values. Yeah, bones, for example, have positive values starting with 100. The lung, on the other hand, that's air-filled, so that has strongly negative values. The lung vessels are not so negative. And then we have, as the second dimension, the distance. Yeah. So there would be considerable overlap here in the intensity intervals for lung vessels and lung opaque, the lung tissue. But we have a distance to the lung surface. All these measures here relate to the lung surface. And that says that there is a completely different intervals. These do not overlap with each other for the distance dimension for the lung vessels and for lung opaque. Yeah. So that is how this would look like visually. Yeah, these different intervals in the two dimensions leading to rectangles here. And that is the resulting visualization. Yeah. The very thin lung surface is shown that has a distance interval of just 1 millimeter. Then we had this 23 millimeter interval where we are interested in the vascular structures, and even more internally, we want to see the lung tissue. Yeah. So there is no medical problem you can solve with this visualization. That is just to show how this can be applied and to give one example for such a target surface, target structure, in this case the lung. So you could emphasize, for example, the outer surface. That is the more relevant example, the useful example. We have the vasculature of the liver. We have a tumor segmented. And we have a distance volume computed that tells you for every voxel how far it is away from the tumor. And that could be used in order to increase the opacity for those vessels that are within a certain margin around a tumor, let's say 10 millimeters. Yeah? So that's almost a smart visibility technique. Yeah? It prefers the visibility of structures close to our target structure, reducing the visibility of other structures. So, and of course, a distance-based transfer function not only can be applied to the opacity value and thus affect the visibility, it can also be applied to colors, yeah, as you see in this example. Yeah. Here we have three different colors representing vascular structures in different safety margins around the tumor. Yeah. So since the tumor is already red, we could not use red again, so we used orange, yellow, and green. And more or less, this says that the green vessels are already quite safe, so probably we do not need to resect them if we want to surgically treat that patient. But we have to definitely adjust, we have to think about the vessels that are closer to the tumor. Probably these have to be resected. At least the orange ones, that's the 5 millimeter security margin. The yellow vessels represent the 10 millimeter security margin. So that could be realized with distance-based transfer functions. Yeah, I hope that's clear so far. And then I will present some more ideas that are, I would say, a bit more academic, not so clearly evaluated from a clinical point of view, but still I think they have potential also for clinical applications, and that's why I wanted to introduce them as well. The first idea is to compute the size of features in different representations of the data, in a multi-scale representation of the data, so that a transfer function can be chosen in such a way that structures of a certain size are emphasized. Of course, we still have the intensity values, so it's also a kind of two-dimensional transfer function where we use both intensity and feature size to compute opacity values and colors, and finally to decide what should be visible. Another of these advanced ideas relates to shape-based transfer functions. Shape-based transfer functions consider objects that are segmented so that we know which voxels belong to them. And then we can classify them whether they are elongated tubular structures or whether they are blobby structures. That means they are more or less compact. They have a similar extent in all directions. Or whether we have structures that are more surface-like, I would call them. That means they have a larger extent in two directions, but in the third direction, the distance is small. Yeah, this Shape-based analysis is then also taken into account for deciding what should be visible. Yeah. So let's start with the size-based transfer functions, an idea from Carlos Correa and Juan Liu Ma. So they wanted to emphasize features of a certain size. This image here is not from their publication, it's instead from Wikipedia, but it shows very well what I think needs to be shown, namely so-called image pyramid, where you start with a high resolution image and you apply blurring on it with the Gaussian filter, for example, and you downsample to a lower resolution, and that is done several times hierarchically. So here we have from level 0 to 4, in total 5 representations, and we can compute the size of features. Some features will disappear when we downsample them. Yeah, features that were very small here already will not be represented after blurring in the downsampled variant. Yeah, so this is the information that is applied here. Correa did something a little bit differently. He also had such a pyramid, but not with discrete representations. He had a continuous scale space. Yeah. So we have our volume data set, and for our continuous scale space, diffusion is applied as the kind of blurring process. And then we determine in which features, in which scales, we see a particular feature very well. So, for example, this pathology is seen very well in this scale, whereas other structures would be visible in other scales. Yeah. So that is then back projected. And here you see an image where the color denotes the size of features. Blue stands for the lowest values, red for the highest values. The specific color scale is not shown here, that's a pity. But yeah, I think you can imagine this scale ranging from blue over green, yellow to orange. Yeah. So we have scalar values with respect to the intensity. We have the size-based information, and based on this information, we adjust color and opacity. Yeah, and that leads to a visualization like this. Yeah, here we have a conventional volume rendered image where we only consider intensity for both transfer function, color and opacity. So we can this way discriminate the vascular structures from everything else quite well and assign a prominent color, but we cannot discriminate the pathologies from other parts of the vascular tree. Here, on the other hand, we have intensity and size, and we are interested primarily in objects with a large size. So this one here is the actual transfer function, saying that everything that is small should not be shown at all, and then the visibility should increase, and only for large structures the opacity should be at its maximum value, and that leads to the emphasis of these structures. Yeah, with respect to the intensity values, similarly, structures with very low intensity values are occluded, and that relates to most of the structures in such a data set, so that only vascular structures are shown at all. Yeah. So maybe it's a good idea we look together 1 minute of this YouTube video.
Size-based transfer functions are new transfer functions that map the local scale or size in a volume to color and opacity. Yeah. To illustrate this, we show a number of data sets classified with a one-dimensional transfer function, and then we show them with a color mapping that varies from warm to cool colors as feature size decreases. Now it is possible to classify volumes based on the relative size of their components. Our methodology consists of 3 stages. diffusion, scale detection, and back projection. What follows is an illustration of our method. First, we show the process using linear diffusion, and then the result of our proposed nonlinear diffusion filter. In this example, we use size-based transfer functions to classify a CT hand dataset. We can see that a transfer function based solely on data values cannot separate bones from blood vessels. With a size-based transfer function, these two features have different scales, here seen as spheres.
Yeah, I think that's enough. You are, of course, welcome to look at the whole video. That's 4 minutes in size. I think that was a quite good explanation, and also it was quite useful to see it, how the structures move, so that you get a better depth perception of the data sets. These are the same data sets as you see here. So that was a video that was created as supplementary material to this publication. Yeah, this hand data set we have also seen already. Again, the comparison between conventional volume rendering with a one-dimensional transfer function mapped to color and opacity. And here two examples where the size is taken into account. Here it is applied, the size is taken into account to determine the color, not the opacity. Whereas here it is applied in such a way that the color and the opacity are influenced by the size of the features that are detected. Nonlinear diffusion was mentioned as the process to create this scale space. Nonlinear diffusion is a quite lengthy computation, but it is known that it leads to really good results. Nonlinear diffusion is often used in image processing also for smoothing. Yeah? Nonlinear anisotropic diffusion, that is probably the best smoothing method. One image-based idea that's actually not difficult, but could be quite useful, is entitled stroke-based transfer functions. It's also from 2008 from Timo Rupinski. So that was a great year for transfer function research. So here the idea was that the user can do two different things. He can make strokes on the data, as you see here, this green one, and here's another one, to specify this is something that I want to see in the volume rendered image. And he can make other strokes, these are the blue ones, a little less visible here due to the lower contrast, specifying this is what I want not to see in the resulting visualization, what I want to exclude. Yeah. And what you see here are the intensity distributions along these rays, the profiles, as we have discussed them earlier. And they are analyzed with the goal to select a transfer function that separates the regions that should be visible from those where the user specifically has said these should not be visible. Yeah? And here would be an example of this, showing quite nicely the skeletal structures. What I find quite convincing here is really the interaction to specify this transfer function, because here is a clear relation between what the user is doing, what the intent of the user is, and the properties of the resulting visualizations. Yeah? When the user adjusts parameters of a typical one-dimensional transfer function, that is not related to the geometry of the involved structures, so that is much more indirect and often needs more trial and error to come up with a good solution. So we had size-based transfer functions and stroke-based transfer functions, another instance of this family of advanced transfer function techniques is shape-based transfer functions. We need object segmentations as an input for this method, and in practice this of course is a limitation. there are situations like radiation treatment planning where segmentations are regularly done, but yeah, radiation treatment planning is not the majority of the cases in clinical practice. So often no segmentations are available. It would be sufficient to have a rough segmentation. It's not important where exactly the border of the objects is. It is sufficient to know the overall shape. Yeah? And then these objects are decomposed with a skeletonization. That is just a technique that helps a lot in order to characterize shapes. And the skeleton has different segments, namely the points that connect branchings. And these should not be too small. Yeah? So small segments would be merged with others so that a certain minimum size results. And then these sub-objects, yeah, based on the merged segments, can be assessed with respect to tubiness, surfaceness, and blobbiness. Yeah? And basically, this is achieved by applying a principal component analysis to these sub-objects. Principal component analysis leads to a new coordinate system that is adapted to this object instead of having axis-aligned coordinates. And in this new object coordinate system, you have three eigenvectors and three corresponding eigenvalues that tell you whether you have, for example, a tubular structure. A tubular structure would be one where one eigenvalue is very large and the two other eigenvalues are quite small. Yeah? So there's a strong difference between the first eigenvalue and the second and third. Surfaceness, high surfaceness, would mean that a structure has two large eigenvalues and only the third one is small. And blobbiness means that the three eigenvalues have approximately the same size. A sphere, for example, is a perfectly blobby structure. So blobbiness then would be one, and surfaceness and tubiness would be zero. So as a consequence of this classification, each object gets three numbers, tubiness, surfaceness, and blobbiness. The sum of these three values equals one. No value is negative, so they are all between zero and one. So an object could be halfway between surfaceness and blobbiness, but it's clearly not tubular. Yeah? So that is the kind of information that we have. And this can be nicely arranged in a triangle representation, as you see here. Yeah? So here are blobby structures. That means objects with almost equal eigenvalues that are placed here in the triangle. Elongated structures are represented here with high tubiness values and very low values for surfaceness and blobbiness. And here are the objects that have high values for surfaceness. Yeah? And this visual representation, of course, could be used so that the user is able to say, I'm interested in these objects. Yeah? He draws a circle around it, or a polygon, or a rectangle, yeah? Simple shape, and that characterizes the objects the user is particularly interested in. Yeah? Was an idea from Prasny and Rupinski in 2009. Yeah, and here we see some examples. Again, a data set with cerebral vasculature and cerebral aneurysms. So, shape-based transfer functions help here to emphasize blobby structures. And this works quite well in this situation because all other portions of the vascular trees are not blobby-like structures. Yeah, these are elongated structures. They have high values for tubiness, not high values for blobbiness. Here you see how this would look like with a conventional transfer function. Fortunately, the aneurysm is at least visible quite well, but it is by no means emphasized and still can be easily overlooked. Yeah, so Yeah, shape classification is made available via an easy to use interface, a graphical interface. No histogram analysis is needed. Yeah, we have discussed these things separately, shape-based transfer functions and size-based transfer functions, and also stroke-based transfer functions. It would be possible also to combine these ideas, yeah, to have one comprehensive user interface for transfer function design that provides access to the shape space as it is necessary for shape-based transfer functions, as well as to the multi-scale representation as a prerequisite for size-based transfer functions. So, and finally, I want to present an idea that I somehow used already in the multimodal medical visualization lecture, namely visibility-driven transfer functions. You recognize this name already. That's again Carlos Correa. So he really made a number of contributions to enhance the transfer function specification process. Here, for each intensity value, it is computed how visible these voxels are on average, depending on the current viewpoint on the one hand and the current opacity transfer function on the other hand. Yeah, you remember that anything that is visibility related and thus dependent on the viewpoint needs to be recomputed when the orientation of the camera changes or when the position of the camera changes. But as long as this is not the case, for example, because the user looks just at the data or moves a clipping plane through the data, this information can be used. Yeah? And these visibility histograms that are needed here as a prerequisite for applying a transfer function to this information can be computed quite fast with the support of the GPU meanwhile. Yeah? So therefore, this is feasible. Yeah, we looked in similar examples in the multimodal visualization lecture. Here, let's do this again for one data set. This is the visibility histogram after a 1D transfer function was adjusted. And we see that the skin is visible quite well, the flesh and also the bone should be visible quite well, but actually it is not. Yeah, even with this transfer function that assigns highest values to the opacity of the bones, due to these smaller peaks here before, the bones are basically not visible. Yeah, so the magenta shaped area, that is the actual visibility. The visibility for the skin as well, and for flesh also, but for the bone it is really very low, despite the transfer function that tries to emphasize the bones, just because the bones are internal structures. So even this low or moderate opacity for skin and flesh prevents that we see the bones. Yeah? Having this in mind, the user here makes another transfer function, saying we want to use high values for opacity here. So that has not changed compared to this transfer function, but for the other peaks in the histogram representing skin and flesh. What is flesh? Flesh is the soft tissue, yeah, muscles, for example. Yeah, only very low opacity values are assigned here, 0.0 something. Yeah, and that leads to the situation that even if there are, let's say, 20 voxels of skin and flesh in front of the skeletal structures, even their cumulative opacity is low enough so that the skeletal structures can be seen. Yeah, so the visibility histogram here is a nice background information, making it possible to adjust transfer functions that make something deliberately visible. That was everything I wanted to say with respect to transfer functions. Multiplanar reformatting means that we apply planes to create two-dimensional visualizations that are not orthogonal to the original coordinate system, not axis-aligned planes, but somehow oblique. Yeah, here you see an example. By the way, you also see what kind of polygon may arise here. Yeah, in this case, it has five angles, five corners. Could also have six corners. That's the maximum. It could be even smaller. Could be a triangle or a rectangle as well. Yeah. So, and that is very often used for the diagnosis of vascular diseases. So what you see here is that the user has an oblique plane that is exactly orthogonal to the vessel center line. And the user may go forward and backward, and the orientation of this plane is always adjusted automatically so that it is a cross-sectional plane through the vascular structures, showing as much as possible from the vascular cross-section. Yeah? And that is what you see here. So this image is the undistorted variant of this one here. Yeah? Here you see this internal center line, which is used to compute such a plane. By the way, what you see here is another reformation of the data set. That's a curved planar reformation that basically shows the whole vascular structure as if it is stretched, and then you can easily see whether there are any abnormalities with respect to the diameter, yeah, whether there is a stenosis, for example, yeah. And here this is even quantified and measured. Here's an artifact, so something is probably wrong here. That could easily be happen if the center line is not absolutely in the center, or in case of branchings, yeah. Yeah, so local multiplanar reformations are not applied to the whole data set, but only for a small region, as you see it here, and that shows a little bit this construction process. Yeah, finally, I want to briefly explain the idea of anatomical reformatting that is due to Volker Dicken, which was my colleague at Fraunhofer Mewis at that time. So he used segmentation information to create a reformatation, planar visualization, based on the segmentation result. So as an example, where he was particularly interested in was to see slices where all voxels are shown that have the same distance to the lung surface. Yeah, so that in the first slice you see everything that's only a millimeter away from the lung surface, and then everything that's 2 millimeters away, and so on. Yeah, so that's a curved surface, and yeah, it's like peeling this organ, what you then see. Clinically, this was motivated by the fact that many lung tumors are at the outer borders of the lung. And if you want to efficiently explore the outer borders of the lung, such a kind of reformation would be very helpful. Volker coined the term anatomical reformatting to describe this technique, because the way the reformatation is carried out depends on anatomical structures, is derived from anatomical structures. Yeah. So that would be one screenshot of this that shows a particular distance to the lung surface. Yeah, with this I'm at the end of this lecture on interaction techniques that are frequently applied to medical volume data to explore them, to get a good understanding, to detect features like cerebral aneurysms or tumors in an efficient manner. Yeah, they are quite important for clinical practice. Medical visualization is not primarily about generating high quality images that are printed on a poster, but they are part of an exploration process typically carried out on a computer to support the diagnostic process of a physician. Interaction should be simple. That's important to avoid obstacles when things are just too difficult to learn. But simplicity, of course, is not the only goal. They should also be flexible enough so that physicians are really able to emphasize the structures they are interested in. A good trade-off is often achieved by making presets available, presets that can be directly used or perhaps incrementally adapted. So that is a better way of interacting with medical volume data than just providing an interface that has enormous flexibility and allows the user to do everything without any guidance. Yeah? Presets provide some guidance. With respect to transfer functions, I want to remind you to the idea we discussed in the beginning, namely image galleries that are created, for example, in a stochastic sampling process where the parameter space is sampled. And the user basically specifies examples of what he likes and finds interesting. And thus, he has not to know at all how the internal transfer function looks like that was used to create these examples that are part of the image gallery. With respect to extensions over one-dimensional transfer functions, I explained a lot. Distance-based transfer functions, shape, stroke, size-based transfer functions, all of them I would not expect in a radiology workstation. Yeah? They have not made it in clinical practice. What is available even in clinical practice are gradient-based transfer functions. Yeah? The idea that the gradient magnitude is considered as the second dimension, that is used more widely. Even this idea is not so easy to realize in practice. I mentioned this also because the gradient information is not as standardized as the intensity information is. It depends on the specific image acquisition parameters for a CT scanner. Yeah, let me comment a bit on the list of references. We have discussed several advanced techniques developed by Carlos Correa. I made extensive use in the first part of the video lecture of the paper from Gordon Kindelman and Durkin, semi-automatic generation of transfer functions for direct volume rendering. That is a seminal paper with several hundreds of citations. That was this paper where a model of an edge was presented first, and as a consequence, it was studied which gradient values and curvature values can be expected when we have an edge. And that was a kind of analysis that turned out very useful to develop reusable transfer functions for volume rendering. I want to also point you to the state-of-the-art report on transfer functions designs from 2016. There are not so many new developments in the last 4 years, so I would say that this is still up to date. Yeah? And these are further references, stroke-based transfer functions, for example, including some work that we have done in our group, like the master thesis from Diana Stölzel and from Andreas Tappenbeck. Yeah, with this, I want to thank you for your attention. See you.